brain. I'm in a world I can't look at me straight. I step up closer to the edge of her waist. All sweat, can't wait.
Well, howdy, howdy.
Hello, my friend. How are you?
Hello, and holy shit. Welcome back to Tuesday Weekly Whiskey. John, it is good to see you. That was a cranking way to start off a great night.
Yeah, I wanted to make sure we could fire it up the right way, you know?
I like it, and I am fired up for tonight. This is going to be awesome. So thank you guys, everyone, for joining us. Con40 in the chat is right. Will is our Regis Philbin, and we love it. It's great to have him. But before we get to that, let's go ahead and catch up on some news. First off, if you're drinking something great, go ahead and let us know in the chat. We have some great stuff to drink here tonight because it is an Our Bourbon Single Barrel Selection Night. But before we get to that, we do have some other barrel news. Next week is a big week. We have our last barrel single barrel, which hopefully you guys all saw and watched that. That is going on sale. New Riff Diamond in the Riff 3 is going on sale, as well as our Nashville Barrel Company Vaporwave Flav, which is a fun-ass 8-year MGP rye. So lots of great stuff coming on board. And I think that drop is 3 barrels, and the drop after that is 7 barrels. So things are heating up here. But that's it for news, I think. So what are we up to tonight, John?
Man, it's always a good thing when you can drop like 3 barrels and have that be it for news, right?
A small week, yeah. You know,
yeah, just a couple of barrels, flowing your way.
Some
I like everything about it, man. So, geez, I'm so excited to just dive into these. I kind of want to start drinking it before we even let everybody into the show.
Oh, you can't do that. No.
okay, fine. I'll think about waiting, but maybe I won't. So anyway, we're going to be selecting something pretty cool tonight. You want to talk about what it is real quick, and then we'll bring our guests in here and introduce them?
Yeah, we'll dive in. So first off, it is technically a holiday for some folks in the nation, which means it is time to welcome Will Schragis on this evening. We are picking a Stellum Spirits single barrel for our bourbon. Stellum Spirits is brand new. They just they took the paint off of that not too long ago, probably the beginning of the month. And that is a kind of a spinoff project, separate brand from Barrell Craft Spirits. But all the great minds behind that brand are at play here as well, which is exciting for us. So we are picking a bourbon single barrel at Barrel Proof. We have some great guests tonight. And I think with that,
and why don't somebody
we
just from the panel as well, correct?
Yeah. We're joined with Prelude SH Mike. He, if he looks familiar with that huge wall of whiskey behind him, it's because he helped us last year for the Smooth Ambler. So it's good to have you back. Welcome again, Mike.
Hey, thanks, guys. Thanks for having me. I'm excited to do this.
Yeah, same. You're the resident barrel fan geek, whatever the equivalent to Rare Bird is, but for barrel. Yeah. So this was essentially a no-brainer. Like, I feel like it would have been wrong not to.
I appreciate being here. And yeah, I'm pumped for this. I look forward to everything that this new brand has coming out. So let's see what they got.
Awesome.
All righty. Well, then I guess without much further ado here, we'll bring in Will Schragis and Nick from Barrell and Stellum, and they will start kicking this off for you guys.
Yeah, welcome, guys.
Thank you so much for having us.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Totally. Absolutely. Well, why don't you give us a quick blurb on what you guys do, and then we'll, and maybe if you have some interesting perspective on Stellum for us.
I guess I can talk about Stellum for a second, and then Nick, if you want to talk about, you know, your role in all the blending and single barrel of it. Stellum is a project that has been about 2 years in the works from Joe Beatrice, the owner and founder of Barrell, and Nick and me and the rest of the team that sort of do his bidding in our own departments. And it went through a bunch of different iterations in terms of sort of designing how we wanted to talk about the whiskey. But really what it came from was us having built out our bottling facility and aging practices and systems from a whiskey production, a blending and production standpoint, where we really controlled everything. And we had a lot of barrels in the pipeline and a lot laid down and a well designed distribution network and route to market. And we wanted to design a project that would not have been possible when we started Barrell using all of the assets that we had with Barrell. But we weren't exactly sure what we wanted to do yet. And we talked to a lot of people around the industry, consumers, distributors, stores. And whereas Barrell was designed to find a place that we felt like we could make the best whiskey at that price on the shelf, we felt like there was this soft spot again for really well executed cask strength bourbon and rye, like simple, what people want to drink around America, at a price point that is less than Barrell, but also one that we still feel like felt like we could over deliver as a producer that is still relying on other distilleries, even though we've owned a lot of these barrels for many years. And because it's Joe, he said, like, step one is this is going to be cast strength no matter what. We did a lot of test blends. We worked on what we had in the pipeline. We saw what was available. And we really decided, like, let's make one bourbon and one rye. And then that was about 2 years ago. And since then, the hunger for single barrels has just like exploded in America. And Nick joined the company about 2 years ago now, right, Nick?
Yeah.
And I know you guys know this, but quietly, Barrell Craft Spirits has like the most extensive single barrel and private release program in the country. There's so many offerings. And so we had these systems built out in our internal way of doing things. So we decided if we're going to launch this slightly more minimalist, pared down, really trying to execute like one really good, always the same cask strength bourbon, one really good, always the same cask strength rye. Let's do like a huge single barrel program at the same time. So there's four releases of Stellum: 114.98 proof cask strength bourbon, always available, always the same; 116.4 proof, always the same cask strength rye. Those are both blends of different states. And then to start, Indiana single barrels released at cask strength, not hard to get your hands on, always available. And we're putting like all of our might and systems behind doing that in a different way. While we were talking about doing that, one of the conversations we had is that like the way that the bourbon industry existed is really outdated. The motif in a lot of the branding and the bottling that people are doing, the way that people like to do business. We were having phone calls with distributors and like people didn't know how to use Zoom 10 months into a pandemic. and our company has always been about like, we don't do things the way other people do. We're going to look at what needs to be done right now to get better at and make better whiskey no matter what. And so the like hard attitude behind Stellum is the whiskey's going to speak to itself. And the soft attitude behind Stellum is we're going to constantly analyze how to do things better given the existence of what's going on in America right now. And part of that is looking around and seeing who's drinking whiskey in America right now. And it's every type of person that, lives in America. It's not people who own horses. It's everyone. And so I was excited to come as a holiday guest on this because as Barrell, it's a very non-political company, has no opinion about the holiday today. I think Stellum would say that no one should go to jail for smoking anything in America.
I love it. That's amazing.
But I'm also super excited to have Nick on the show today because I don't get to hang out with Nick in public all that often because she's so busy picking barrels and blending. But Nick runs both the Barrell and the Stellum single barrel program and then also sits on the blending team with Joe and Tripp. And she's watched a lot of the episodes with you guys and decided to jump in and join us for such a special pick. So I guess this is my introduction to people who haven't met her before, but this is Nick who makes my job very easy by helping put together some of the best whiskey in the country.
Golf claps.
Yeah. Well, thanks, Will. I'm super happy to be here. It's been a weird year with the pandemic and things, so I don't get to do barrel selections in person anymore. Not really. It's rare. So it's fun to be here and doing with you guys and I'm happy I'm on the show. So yeah.
Nick, you put together the previous selection that we did just the other week, right? With the crazy ass 5-year that we wound up picking.
Yeah.
Good. That was like the most interesting lineup. And there was a lot of really cool stuff in there, and I was super pumped about it.
That was a good time.
That's one of the things that is really fun about with using BCS barrel selections is we have so many different things to choose from. You can really throw together an interesting set. But with Stellum, it's, you know, we're doing all bourbon tonight, so it's a few different mash bills. But besides that, it's all just, you know, straightforward bourbon that's really good.
That's going to be my next question was the mash bills. Okay, keep going. Will,
we had a really cool moment, I don't know, 2 weeks ago or so with Nick, because we just recently rolled out the single barrel program. You guys are some of the first people to pick a barrel of Stellum. And our distributor in Texas, our Stellum distributor, wanted to have 6 single barrels available to break up and allocate like 1 case per account. And they were naming them after country songs. And they said, can Nick pick 6 barrels for us? You know, the person who's like helping select all of the barrels that go into the single barrel program, can you just pick 6, make them really different and make sure she knows these are going to be what show off the barrel program to Texas. So like make them good. And I think they would say that to anyone. Nick goes, takes home like 48 samples for the weekend, comes back with notes on her favorites and then backups if they weren't different enough. And the distributor's like, oh shit. And I have to send them a note being like, we don't do this for everyone, and Nick doesn't have time to do this all the time. So, like, don't ask if you don't want it to happen. But if you want Nick to put some time into the selection, like, we're going to do it.
If you want Nick to sample 48 fucking whiskeys in 1 week, she'll happily do it. But don't make her do it all the time.
Oh, my kitchen table, I'll just cover it with samples and, you know, just take notes and go.
Unreal.
Rockstar.
Kind of the best homework.
Definitely.
I feel like they felt bad though. They were like, oh, we just wanted her to pick good one. Like, we didn't need someone to like spend their entire weekend picking barrels for us.
Well, she picked the best ones. What do you think?
Yeah, about and that? So if anyone in Texas listening to this, there's 6 country music themed barrels coming there, and they are the fruits of Nick's no weekend labor.
That is the most Texas thing I've ever heard. That's amazing. Yeah. Well, cool. I think that sets the stage well. So we have what? We have 4 samples in front of us here tonight. Mm-hmm. They're aptly but oddly named. We've got Stellum being a very planetary kind of thing. We have Cygnus and Lyra sets of samples.
Yeah, so those are both what we call clusters of barrels. What's interesting about single barrel programs is all the barrels are different because they're different whiskeys. But they often like come from same parts of like, it'll be a whole row of barrels from a rickhouse that we liked or a large selection that Nick or Trip or Joe made out of a specific mash bill that we liked working with, or set of barrels that we were particularly fond of in part of our warehouse. So they kind of were in families already.
Okay.
And so what we decided to do with the single barrel program for Stellum, because it's just bourbon and rye right now, is every barrel has its own number, which is a letter, or like its own name, a letter and a number. And then it is also in a cluster name. And so this is two barrels from the Cygnus cluster, which makes up the 36%, so the really high rye Indiana mash bill, of the first selection of that we did. And then two barrels from the Lyra cluster, which is the 21% rye mash bill.
Okay.
And there will be other clusters of those mash bills, but these are the first two, like the first cluster of 36, the first cluster of 21 is called Cygnus and Lyra. The reason we wanted to do that is we know there's like a collectability with single barrels. And so to have them have relations to each other that are obvious based on the label, but also very unique names. So like there's 10 Cygnus B barrels, but there's only one Cygnus B1 barrel. There's Cygnus B2, Cygnus B3s. And that means they're from the same selection, from the same mash bill. We're sitting next to each other.
Okay.
And so on and so forth. So you can learn a lot about the relationship between the barrels based on the numbers. But the cluster will change.
Okay. So what I'm hearing is that I need to get a Stellum whiteboard to put next to my barrel whiteboard on the wall.
Yeah, but also like, you know, we learned a lot from what people were excited about with other single barrel programs. And I think the Four Roses single barrel program is a really good model for the best barrels are the ones that people pick when they're just tasting them and they're not trying to worry about what it is. But then it's pretty cool to see the yeast strains in the warehouses and things like that. And so obviously our program is a little bit more pared down than that with Stellum, but every barrel will have a cluster and a family number and a number within the family number.
Okay. That's cool. I like that. And you took one of the questions right out of my mouth. I assume we were working with 36 and 21%. Mm-hmm. From MGP, which is the rye content, which is cool. I think it's always fun to put those head to head, especially blind.
No word on the warehouses these came from.
That's a lot of the Indiana barrels that we work with are aging in different places, and so no. The answer is no, but not because we're hiding it, but because there isn't really an answer to that. Their barrel sourcing is more complicated than anyone wants to let on.
Okay.
That's fair. So there's a chance that you've owned these barrels for a while. These aren't necessarily just sitting in Indiana and then you're picking them up and then they're going straight to a bottle. That's what you're saying.
Yeah. And then also they all went through a vetting process where they were selected to be in the single barrel program and not to be used in one of the blends for Stellum.
Okay.
Well, I mean, that sets the stage very nicely. Lots going on. As per the
Let's usual. Dig in. Let's get some whiskey going.
Yeah, so we are starting with Cygnus B1, right?
Correct.
I nosed through these while you guys were doing the intro, and I thought I had a clear winner from the nose, but I didn't. There was one that when I smelled it, I was like, I don't even have to smell the other ones. This is going to be my favorite. But then I smelled,
Go ahead. I did that too. And then I had one that I immediately was like, oh, I know it's not that one. But I haven't tasted through yet, so I'm excited to see where this goes. And also, I thought that there were three mash bills here. Not even looking at the labels, just going through on the nose. There was one of them that stood out to me in a different way. So this will be really fun. I already like where this is going, and I hope it gets so much weirder.
We use a third mash bill, the 99% corn mash bill, in the mm-hmm. blend for the core bourbon of Stellum.
I thought one of these was that 99.
If you want to talk to that, go for it. But we don't have any of the single barrel program yet.
Okay. Yeah,
not yet. We might slip a few of them in there just because they're fun. But yeah, the Stellum Bourbon Blend is, you know, the three mash bills of Indiana kind of all working together to bring out flavors with, you know, a little bit of Tennessee, a little bit of Kentucky in there. But it's the majority of it is the three mash bills.
Okay. Very cool. When you do roll out a 99% corn, you should let me know. I've been trying to track down.
He has for corn. Like an embarrassing amount of time.
It's disgusting how long I've been trying to get a cask of corn.
Interesting. Okay.
And people are oddly resistant to selling it, which makes no sense to me.
We find that it's a wonderful ingredient, but very rarely a good complete whiskey. But knowing who's looking for them, you have the right person on this, and it's not me. So you're going to make my compliance life very complicated because I'm going to get a call from Nick that says, remember those guys, I've got something for them now.
Yes.
And I'm going to have to figure out how to get it through the system in a way that doesn't cause a problem because we only did one.
Okay. Wow. When you're ready for us to make your life
for us, though. So. Yeah. So I want to circle back to something you said earlier, Will. You said that right now, and you seem to emphasize the right now, in that there's only going to be bourbon and rye under Stellum banner. Mm-hmm. Is that a tease that there's going to be more coming?
There's nothing in the pipeline right now, but okay. I'm careful just not in saying that.
Shut door.
Yeah, because I don't want to say we will never do that and then do it. Sure. And as you guys know, our entire company is really into wood experiments right now. And there's a lot of R&D that we do that we feel declassifies things out of bourbon and rye. And so I would imagine at some point Stellum will have something that'll make it so that we don't call it a bourbon or a rye anymore. But there's no plans for that right now.
Okay, cool. I figured I had to ask it since you said it in there. Wanted to make sure that we checked off all the boxes.
We're not making Stellum gin, if that's what you're asking.
But if you do...
The one thing I want.
And you bet if we do, it'll be really high proof. But that's definitely not the plan.
Man. Well, you know, the world isn't ready for 85% gin yet. Someday.
It depends on where you're in the world you are, I think.
Russia?
Yikes.
All right, interesting. So I just nosed through all four.
Yeah, I've been going through these on the nose and getting the initial thought on the palate on these. And actually, I'm not sure this will take us too long, actually.
I'm curious, what are you smelling, Mike? Do you have any preferences on the nose?
I do, but as I was smelling through and then as I was tasting, the nose that I like the best has not been the one that I thought has tasted the best.
Okay. Okay.
So I kind of like Lyra E7 on the nose.
Mm-hmm. That's the one that when I smelled it, was like, I don't have to smell the others.
Yeah. Yep. It stood out the most. It's the brightest. It's got just enough sweetness and just enough fruit for me that that's what I hit on first every time. And you know, the weird thing is every time I go to a store and I see, like, I hate to throw out competition, but a Remus pick or a Smooth Ambler pick. And I ask, hey, is this high rye or low rye? You know, if they have a choice, I'll always say, just give me the high rye. That's all I want. And I'll be damned if every time I go in and I side by side a high rye and a low rye, I end up picking the low rye. And I don't know why, even though my mind tells me you like the high rye more. So, I like this E7 a lot on the nose, but.
I think it's also
what everyone else thinks.
It's interesting that the phrase high rye is tossed around a lot, and 21% rye for almost any distillery besides Indiana would be considered a high rye bourbon.
Oh, definitely.
And yep. So these are all high rye. It's just two of them are
higher,
excessively high rye.
Right.
And after watching Nick and Tripp and Joe go through so many iterations of the core blend of Stellum, really thinking of those mash bills as ingredients to allow bigger companies to put proprietary blends together, you realize what their strengths and weaknesses are. And yeah, I mean, I really like a lot of the Cygnus series, but I find there's a higher percentage of intriguing single barrels in the 21% rye world than there are in the 36% rye world. The 36% rye world and the 99% corn, to me, like, they function almost better as vatted ingredients, except for some select great barrels that come out of it.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, that one's nice. That one stood out to me on the nose, too. It was like a very, like, an extremely creamy profile, which was fun with the fruit.
Yeah.
The nose on Cygnus B1 is a little on the grainy side. Nothing crazy, but
yeah, I agree. Almost an astringent
note. What'd you think about B5 on the nose?
I do like B5 on the nose.
Yeah, B5.
That one dove out at me. It's like a hot buttery cornbread.
Yeah, and s'mores.
Yeah. That one stood out to me on the nose instantly. And then I don't remember which one it was. Actually, my first taste through of the Lyra, I didn't like one of them right off the bat. And then I came back through and I just tasted them each side by side. And I was wrong because I don't dislike either of them. So I'm a fucking liar.
Hey, Nick, I have a question for Nick.
Yeah.
When you go through, like, you know, 48 samples at a time, how do you break them down to where you can definitively say this is better than this? Or do you just keep breaking them down into like brackets, like a March Madness, to where you keep retesting them? Or do you just give them a definitive score and say, okay, on to the next one?
It's more of a, it starts off as more of a quickly analyzing. So always knows. Most of the time I'll nose more than I actually taste. So I'll start there and then do like a quick, you know, yes, no, separate out the nose, go back again and kind of do that again until I get down to like a smaller number that I can actually like dig deep and go through and really take some notes and get there. And on the first go around, sometimes the nose become yeses later. I think it depends on, you know, our palates change all the time and in that set, they just like weren't really showing. So, so it starts off as like a very, I almost know immediately. And then I dig a little deeper as I continue tasting.
Okay.
I think also there's an interesting difference between making a pick in a fun way and having work to do with samples, because when you're making a pick in a fun way, which is, I'm not saying that's a bad thing, but when it's like a exciting, fun activity, you end up spending a lot of time forming a full opinion about all of the options. And when you're sorting, it's about like what is the smallest amount of energy and palate fatigue you can spend on eliminating as many things as you can, so that when you get to the hard decisions, you have enough left in the tank to really make the right decision.
Right. Like, where's the bar? And if it's not going to meet that, let's just get those out of the way quick so we can really hone in when it matters.
Yeah. It's like with four, if something's not good on the nose, you still want to try it.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
With 80, if something's not good on the nose, deal with it another day. Like, don't.
That's totally it.
I can see that.
Yeah. And with blending, sometimes you're looking for a specific fur. So, you know, I want something fruity. So I'm going through quickly and I'm looking for, you know, tropical fruit, or I want spice. I'm looking for those things. And so in that case, I'm doing it the same way, just looking for a specific flavor profile.
Okay.
I think one of the really interesting projects, Nick, that you brought to the blending team when you first sort of started really being part of it was pulling out all the really low proof old Tennessee barrels and vatting, like we didn't use them for other stuff. We just started pulling them out and vatting them and using that ingredient in things. And that was one of Nick's first projects. And that brought a level to some of the blends that I feel like we didn't have before, because we ended up having this ingredient that was, we knew what it would do. It was like low proof old Tennessee bourbon, but at cask strength. By low proof, I mean like 99 to 107.
Oh,
So low.
And,
the low shit.
But it's like, then anything that falls into that doesn't get tasted. It gets vatted because we want to make that ingredient over and over again. And so that helps you eliminate whatever it is, 10, 15% of the barrels in the moments where you're tasting 14, 15, 16-year-old Tennessee.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay. Well, let's see. So has everybody tasted through all four of these? John, Mike,
yes. Yes.
Is there any? So in the past, we usually try and like weed one or two out based on the sample size. We weeded a couple out quick on our last kind of our mother load. But I have one I think I'm not feeling today, and I'm curious if you guys are feeling the same way.
Yeah, I kind of I've got like a very initial sort of a glass slid forward or backward type of ranking system here.
Yeah.
And the one that has crept forward the least is the Cygnus B1.
Okay. Yeah. That's the one I'm thinking my as well.
Me too.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, there was, it was actually on the nose. I thought it was fine when I went through them. I kind of enjoyed it. There, it was like almost a white fruit nectarine type of thing going on in it. But then it like never really kind of evolved from there. And it just didn't do a ton for me after that. And on the palate, it just, if it was the only thing I was drinking, I don't think I'd complain about it. But
yeah,
right next to the ones after it, it just didn't hold up.
I think Cygnus B5 and Lyra E7 have so much weight and power that it's hard, even if you like the other things about Cygnus B1, it's hard to appreciate it next to like, I don't mean heavy hitters as better. I mean, just like louder in everything they're doing barrels.
Correct.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. Those two are the ones that I slid the most forward. And so I compared Lyra A9 and the Cygnus B1 to like really get my lowest rank of the two, and the B1 fell back.
Yeah.
Okay. And the nose was like, the nose was beautiful, but that's where I felt like it peaked.
Yep.
Really beautiful nose, kind of a muted palate.
Yep. So since I sort of fired out that first one, I'll let you guys sort of get to pairing the next ones down, so I'm not steering the ship too heavily there.
Yeah, I do like the B5. And smelling, I'm kind of, the Lyras are the hardest for me. I actually really like them both. But I like one
you
of
like
the
them equally
more.
On the nose and palate, or
I'm tasting again weight a little higher. Now I doubt myself.
Because I had one of them as we started tasting. I was like, oh no, I actually don't really care for that much. And then I kind of went back and did them side by side instead of in the order I originally did them in. And I think that changed it for me just a little bit. But I still, between those two, I still have a clear favorite.
I have my clear. I think that we're going to disagree here, John. Mike, we don't taste as much together, so I'm curious where you fall here, because I think John and I will disagree. But if you had to pick of the two, Lyra, where are you leaning? If you had to pick, if you're between Cygnus and Lyra, then don't let me push you around.
No. Hey, John, I just want to say I did agree with what you said right at the beginning. I would probably toss out the B1 and the A9. But, you know, the more I drink A9, the more I'm like, man, this... If we were having it by itself, it could be something. I think that it's unveiling itself a little bit more as I drink it. But yeah, I'm set kind of now between B5 and E7 is my go-to. And I know, Will, you said to put the name before Cygnus B5, Lyra E7.
In this situation, it's fine because they all have different numbers. But yeah. I just want to make sure people know that like there will be a B5 in another cluster also. And so,
yeah.
We do our best not to send the same numbers to someone because we know it'll get confused, but
right.
Just getting out ahead of that $8,000 disaster.
You sound like you've done this before.
I was going to say, I'm going to put that on a bumper sticker. Like, we know it will get confused. Barrell Craft Spirits. in a good way. But okay, I'm curious. So John, are you feeling the same as Mike?
I am, yeah. I'm Cygnus B5, Lyra E7.
Oh, okay. I really like
it. In between those two, it's going to be a little tricky, but I think if I had to pull the trigger right now, I could.
Okay.
I really want to hear what Nick has to say because I typecast Nick and I'm wrong a lot, but I want to know in my head if I'm guess. I kind of want to write it down. I wish I had a note card here.
Yeah.
Well, thankfully this is recorded.
Line that we did, Will, you had one that you thought for sure Jay was going to like go nuts about too. And he was just like, nah. Yeah, I didn't really care for that.
Yeah, I can't
pitch that one.
It's the worst.
Yeah. Because you were like, oh man, at that. And I was like,
Will was personally offended and somehow deeply hurt in his soul that you didn't choose the one that he wanted.
Yeah. It was a fun cask. It was like,
I would have drank the shit out of that. That was good.
I know, man. It was weird.
There was, if we could have taken a few of those, I probably would have, to be honest with you. There was a couple of really cool ones in there.
I wish I had my bling check ready.
Nick, do you have a favorite of these?
So I was in between Lyra E7 and Cygnus B5. I think A9 is opening up more though. At first it was kind of muted and tight and it wasn't doing as much for me, but when I just went back to it, it's like really, like the nose is really opened up and it's getting better. So I'm not sure where I am yet.
What I was hoping you were going to say, because it was my guess, is that A9 is a cocktail bourbon. Because it's like a little tougher, but it's like got such interesting stuff going on. Yeah. I wanted to write that down and then have you say it and then hold it up. But final jeopardy.
That's something she says.
Cocktails, ding, ding.
It's not necessarily Nick says a lot, but it's the sort of thing that like we'll be in a room and no one will think about it that way. And then Nick will be the person in the room being like, yeah, but if it's going to a bar, they're going to want this one. And I'll just be like, oh, let's show that barrel of bars. That's a good idea. Like the whole, no one in the sales team will have thought of it that way. And Nick will like.
Yeah. It's funny for me because like this A9 actually almost drinks like a cocktail for me. Like it has so much fruitiness to it, with like a little bit of the bitterness on the back end. Like it would not take much for this to like kind of drink like an old fashioned in a glass, at least for my, like it has like this really like vibrant cherry note that just makes it scream old fashioned to me.
And it could take some sugar because it's such a tough whiskey.
Yeah, there's something in there. I think it was something like, and it's not like off-putting, but there was something in there that I kind of caught on the nose the first time through. And then on my first tasting through, I was like, no, I don't think I like that much. And I couldn't quite place it. And at first, I want to say it's like almost like a very, like have you ever had like wild mint? It's like not an actual mint flavor, but it's sort of like wild mint can come through with like so many different type of, like not quite grassy. I don't know. There's something in there that I can't put my finger on. I'm having a hard time articulating, but I do get all that fruit in there and I do like it right up front, but there's just something that sits in there that I can't quite place. And it's like, it's throwing me off a little bit.
I say that, but then I'm going back to Cygnus B5 and that just that like deep brown sugar note in it is so intriguing.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Big desserty note right up front in your face. Will, I got a sales question for you here. Kendrick here wanted to know if Stellum is going to be available at Liquor Barn.
Liquor Barn in Kentucky?
Yes, he works in Louisville, I think.
So we actually just today, it looks like, finalized our launch with a distributor in Kentucky. So the answer is yes, but I would give it 4 to 8 weeks. But yes.
There you go, Kendra.
Okay. Soon. Nice. Soon is a perfectly good answer.
Yeah, Stellum's been a really fun rollout for us because we had a lot of it to start, but we only launched in, I think, 12 states, and everyone reordered it so quickly that we had to delay the rest of the launch because we didn't want to have stock issues. So it was supposed to be in 46 states within 2 months, but instead it's still only in like 12 because we're having to add them as we have the ability to guarantee stock as we go.
Okay. Wow.
No.
So no Wisconsin yet.
Damn right. It's okay. At the rate we're going, I'll just buy single barrels and import them independently.
Okay, last sales question for now is just going to be getting barrel to Ohio. Will, I know that you've been pushing for this. I know it's almost there.
I wish we had Eva on here. She's our Northeastern Brand Development Manager who's handling the Ohio project. Barrel has been submitted to Ohio. We have signed with a broker. Ohio does not have its next listing approval date until the beginning of the summer. So all of the work that we can do is done. And now we're just sitting on our hands and hoping we get a yes in the next couple months.
The ball is in your court, Yancey. Get it done.
Yeah. Get that across the finish line, man. Ohio.
I can't do that one. I said last sales question.
Ohio is so weird, though. Like, I get it. Like, just when you're done with everything, then you still have to wait.
Yep.
Such an Ohio thing. Okay. Going back to Cygnus B5, I agree. Really nice. So I will fall on my sword. It sounds like you guys are ready to take E7 over A9, and I can jive with that.
Okay.
And just dream about A9 afterwards. All right. So we're kind of in the final two here, right? Like Cygnus B5, Lyra E7. Right? Remind.
No,
right.
You're right on that. Okay. I'm ready to cast my vote here, but
Big silence. I was worried I'd mess it all up. Okay.
I was kind of hoping somebody would be like, oh, no, Jay, you're wrong. It's something else. Yeah, idiot. No, I'm just kidding here. Okay. I'll be honest with you. I don't want to be the first one to cast it. I don't want to do it.
Let's. I think that we made Mike go last when we did Smooth Ambler. So, and this is not a declaration. So feel free to duke it out after you make your selection. But I'm curious what you'd place number one and number two and why, and then we'll make John go next.
All right. Well, here is my number one.
Oh, okay. See, look, he's got a pen and a paper handy.
Yeah, I know. I'm going to have to do it for next time.
Will, you got nine bottles and no pens behind you.
Yeah.
When you got nine bottles, you don't need any pens, man.
The words just come to you, I suppose. Okay. So
I'm with you. I'm on B5.
Yeah. Really?
Okay. It's sweeter. I don't know. I was even getting a pancake syrup type taste towards the end. And that's what kind of set it apart from E7.
We're sharing a brain right now.
What's that?
We're sharing a brain right now, man. Yeah.
Yeah.
You're probably using a little bit more of it, if I'm honest, though.
No way, man. But yeah, it's I don't know. I really enjoy this, so it's getting my nod, but I'm interested to hear what you guys think.
I've been team B5 since I nosed through them the first time.
Okay. I like them both. I think that the B5 is the much better bourbon. I find E7 really interesting because it tasted like someone put Ango in it. Like a little spritz of like Ango bitters.
I could see that, yeah.
And that just brings me back to like my Wisconsin bar days, but yeah,
that B5 is really nice.
Shot of Ango, man. After dinner?
Yeah.
Wake you up the old-fashioned way.
It's funny. Nick was just making, what's the drink?
Trinidad Sours.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
In a Stellum photo shoot, right?
That one, it was Barrell's.
Okay.
Seagrass.
Oh.
Okay.
Seagrass, Trinidad Sour. Oof.
I bet that works so well.
I just saw that come up in chat, I think. Somebody was just raving about that.
Oh, yeah, that was the New York sour.
Recipe. Oh, yeah, that was a New York sour. Never mind.
Yeah.
It's got the red wine in the mix.
Yep.
Oh, man.
Dude, where do Trinidad you guys do your photo shoots with that kitchen?
Undisclosed location.
Oh, well.
In a kitchen?
I knew. Yeah, that a bunch of your Barrell photo shoots are in a kitchen, it looks like.
We work with different places around Louisville, local places. Okay. We'll team up with, so I don't think it's actually a kitchen, it just looks like a kitchen.
Oh, okay. Well, makes sense.
Well, you had us fooled, that's for sure. Okay, so Cygnus B5. Yeah, I'm happy with that. I think that's a knockout bourbon.
Yeah, it's unique too. I mean, this is a lineup of all stuff that's actually pretty good. And I did come back to A9 a couple times, and I think you guys are honest. I think it did open up a little bit. But it's more of a thinker, and I think B5 is more of a drinker.
Yeah, I think E7 and A9 are E7 and A9 are sort of asymmetric or untypical barrels in a way that makes them really intriguing. Like Nick, I can totally see why you pulled them into the program. B5 to me, like Cygnus B5, is like it's what the phrase honey barrel comes from. Like it's just so sweet and thick as a single barrel.
And it's interesting, it's the lowest proof out of the four.
Really? Now that surprises me. That surprises me a lot.
Me too.
Lay it on us. What's the details here?
Big reveal.
I need an animation for that.
We should guess first.
Yeah, you want to guess?
I'll guess 57% and 5.5 years. I'm prepared to be totally wrong across the board.
I'll go 53%.
Which one are we even guessing on?
Cygnus, buddy. B5.
B5.
Do you have the month fills in front of you, Nick?
No, I don't have them up.
I could probably find it.
So you're close. It's 107.28 proof.
Damn.
Nice. I'll be darned.
That drink's really rich for 53.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sometimes the lower proof barrels, they get like super concentrated flavor, which is really nice.
Yeah.
This reminds me of those. I don't know if you remember Mike and John, those really, I want to say it was probably 4 years ago, 5 years ago, MGP through Smooth Ambler released a bunch of low, low proof, like 49 yeah. to 53, 54% single barrels that were just like the bee's knees.
Knockouts, yeah.
And nobody bought them because they were low proof.
I haven't had it, but I've heard of those legends.
All right, I have to dig around. I have some hanging around here somewhere.
Did you just look back like they would be like lurking over your shoulder?
Yeah.
Well, I can't remember if I still have them in bottles or if I decanted them into flasks. And I was like, oh. Fair.
So Jay and John, you don't need to answer this now, but we're doing a pet program with the Stellum barrels that I hope you will be okay with participating in, but I won't be upset if you're not. We are asking everyone who we feel have like followers around the country who are selecting barrels before we bottle to allow us to take 12 bottles from their barrel and put them into on-premise only mixed packs labeled with it. So there will be 6 bars around the country that get 2 bottles of your barrel. So that there'll be, we're calling them like spiritual home bars. And they will have a selection of single barrels of Stellum from around the country. They won't know what they're getting. They're going to get a mix pack of them. So it'll just say like Stellum single barrel. But then when they open it, there'll be 2 bottles of 6 different barrels in it for them.
Oh, that's cool as hell.
Yeah, light it up.
And you don't have to do anything. You just have to give us permission to pull a case before we put it into distribution for you to mix into other people's cases.
Yeah, I think that's totally cool. Now, I'll counter with an equally difficult question if we have to like cut this out. That's totally fine. If we really like 2 of these, what is the...
You just got to let me know pretty soon so that we don't show it to anyone else.
Okay, well,
our company policy is if you are talking to us while you're tasting, they're all yours until we're done talking.
Okay, well, I have a ballsy idea. And Blake, who was supposed to be here and is a little bit late, isn't here to tell me no. So I think we're in a pretty good spot. But...
you've beaten me to the punch on that by like 15 minutes here.
I like the E7. What do you say? Should we maybe take both of these? I think it'd be a really, really they're like very different profiles, and I think it'd be fun for home bar country across the country to get 2 very separate things. But I really like this E7. I'm having a hard time not thinking about buying some of this.
I was going to ask Will if we could get them both when we went off air, so I am on board with your plan.
Yeah, I mean, one of the reasons we like doing the clusters is if you know, the people who subscribe to your barrel drops are into these, you know, it would be fun to each time we have a new cluster do a tasting with you guys. And so it fits really well to have 1 Cygnus and 1 Lyra.
Yeah, I'm into it. I think
Hold on. I have to call the single barrel program coordinator to make sure it's okay.
Oh, shit. Did we just...
Oh, no.
Nick, she's right here.
Can we hold 2 of these? Is that okay, Nick?
It's gonna be hard, but let me see what we can do.
Will, could you put her on speakerphone, please?
What's funny is that's actually what would have happened if Nick wasn't. Like, if I didn't know the answer, I would have been like, Nick, do you need the whatever isn't picked, do you need for another tasting or not? So, but we know that these are all good. We sort of suspected you were going to ask that.
I wasn't planning to take more than one, but... I really like the E7. It's so different and it's so fun. And I think it's also so good at the same time. Like it's not an off profile and like, oh, this is weird, but I absolutely love it. And I think that it's a really nice bedfellow to the Cygnus B5, and it coming from a different cluster is interesting in its own right.
Yeah. Curious language notwithstanding. I think that you're onto something there. I'm totally into it,
man. Yeah.
Yeah. I really like you guys would do that too. It makes sense. You got enough buyers, I'm sure, that people want these and probably can't get them. Yeah. So the E7 isn't even a runner up. You know, it's a great other exercise in just how good these can be. And I think that anybody would be happy to get either one of these. I prefer the B5 a little bit more. But yeah, the E7 had us all, you know, questioning which one we really do want more.
Yeah.
And
I had to retaste them 3 times.
Not to be the sales guy on the call, but you know, these are both from the inaugural release of the Stellum barrels. So not that the brand is going anywhere and not that the quality is going to change at all, but we hope within a year or 2 years or 3 years, these first couple clusters are like, well, those were the the release clusters and people want them. So
I just have to say, it's so refreshing in the time of coronavirus to hear the word cluster associated with whiskey. And instead of
I never even thought of that.
Like an endemic virus. It's great. Yeah. I was just thinking, I was like, why does the word cluster sound so weird? Oh, because cluster of cases. But like, all right, I'm super into it. Clusters of whiskey. That's what it should have been all along. I love it. Cluster this up.
I'm with you, man.
Cool. So what is, since we got all in a hullabaloo about the proof and age on B5, or at least the proof, I'm curious on the proof on E7 too.
Yeah, it's 112.16.
Okay. So still pretty respectable as well. 56. Yeah, these drink really nicely for those proofs.
Yeah, I'm excited.
Yum.
Very good.
Beautiful. Well, our work here, I think, is done. We're rolling up kind of on the top of the hour, so that gives us a few more minutes, but I'm excited. So for everyone just tuning in, Cygnus B5 and Lyra E7, Chosen Barrels, two very different profiles, both delicious, super pumped, thumbs ups all around, which is good.
Yeah,
that makes me feel better about leaving A9 off. I really liked A9 too, but that one was like funky.
I'll make sure you know where it goes. I every time we do one of these public tastings and there's one that people like but doesn't get chosen, I end up getting a couple emails being like, I'll take that barrel. And then
Yeah, let me know where it ends up. I'd love to take a couple. If not, it'd be fun to like do these all again blind and see if I like still come up with the same preference.
Yeah, we could arrange that for that. That sounds like a fun thing.
That'd be a great way to humiliate myself and have great whiskey.
Nick does a cool thing where she once a month or so sends blind samples to the whole sales team, and it's always like three or four things that are not Barrell or Stellum, and then one thing that is Barrell or Stellum, and usually at least one thing that no one's expecting and is like very expensive or hard to find, and then like one thing that everyone doesn't think highly of. And it's really funny when someone is very wrong on the sale. It's like it's funny but embarrassing.
Humbling.
Yeah, humbling.
Give us an example of one thing that people don't think very highly of.
I don't like speaking ill of other companies.
Will is in a sales
position. Can you at least say a distiller it came from? No.
I think what is interesting, and Nick, maybe you know this is going to happen every time, but everyone in our company seems to love Old Forester rye.
Oh.
No.
And okay. So anytime there's a rye tasting, everyone loves the Old Forester rye sample all the time. And no one's ever expecting it to be Old Forester rye, but it's just it's an inexpensive bottle, but everyone on our company really likes it.
It's good too. It's way better than it has any right to be for what, like $27?
Yeah, $25.99 here, I think. Yeah.
$23?
Yeah, I'm with you on that. Cheap.
That's funny.
Were there any other questions in the chat that you wanted us to get to? I'm on full screen, so I can't see the chat.
No, I circled back through and I picked out the ones that had shown up earlier. I don't think, well, there was one more question on the sales side for Wisconsin. Barrel.
He said Wisconsin's waiting. We're always waiting.
Yeah.
Yep.
We're here.
We're getting there as quickly as we can.
Keep waiting, Wisconsin.
We're used to waiting. We'll just eat some more cheese curds and suck it up.
Yep. Have a couple of brats.
I did have a brat for dinner.
Of course you did.
I had to like reinforce the stereotype, but it happens constantly.
I bet it had cheddar in it.
It did. It was cheddar onion. It was so good.
Oh my gosh.
I gotta stop now before you guys are like Anna High Life question.
Right? Yeah, I was gonna say Miller Lite, but yeah.
No, I had a Riesling.
Line and Kugel makes Riesling?
What? No.
The champagne of beer is not a Riesling, Jay.
No. Dude, if Line and Kugel made a Riesling, it'd be the most disgusting thing ever. I'll just
let's close this thing out.
Yeah,
we got to get our good barrels going.
on the Lennon Kugel Riesling note, it's time to get out of here.
Thank you guys so much again for having us. And I know that you're good about this, John, so I'll let you do most of it. But Stellum, we're working really hard to make it a brand that people are really excited about. From a production standpoint, I know that, Nick, you haven't gotten a lot of sleep in the past couple months. But also from a communicating standpoint, we want to hear what everyone thinks and what they'd like us to do and where they want us to go and how they want us to do it. So if you want to send us any email, contact@stellumspirits.com. All of, Stellum Spirits, all of the different tags. There you go. I know you had it on deck.
I got you, man.
This has been really exciting for us because we've been working so hard on Barrel for so long. And then we get to like have a coming out party with another brand. And it's the way that people have been responding to it has been so amazing. And we want to talk to everyone about what we're doing because we're so excited about it. So please do get in touch. And all of, we're a small team and we answer all the questions ourselves. So
I love it. That's great. And Nick, if people are looking for your account, if they're looking for your, I know your prime on the mixology scene, where can they find you?
So they can reach out to me, email. It's nick@stellumspirits.com. And then I'm also on Instagram and it's nixologistnick.
Okay, beautiful. I was actually just looking at your profile earlier today from a cocktail thing. So I wanted to get that out there.
Yeah, Nick is a little humble, but Nick was the beverage director at Butchertown Grocery in Louisville before she came to us. And so we rely on her for a lot of the cocktail advice that comes out about the brands too. And so,
man, that's great. I love Butchertown Grocery. I was actually there just a week or two ago.
And it really was the best beverage program in Louisville.
That's great.
Yeah.
Links will.
And then we ruined it when we took Nick.
Snuck right up.
You can pride yourself on that. Yeah.
And actually,
I'd call it a win.
My last time eating there when Nick was working there, we drank Riesling.
So yes.
Tying it back together. Yeah.
It's all coming together. Beautiful.
Full circle. Here we go.
Oh, my love of Riesling is known. But, well, it's amazing. Thank you to Prelude. SH, sorry, it's hard to pronounce that, so I just call you Mike.
Yeah, it's a bad name, but
it's way better than what I would have done to it.
Yeah, I mean, well, thank you
were like
for joining
two
us
for being pre-Ladouche.
Yeah, that's what people say.
That was in my mind for years. It took us doing the smooth hammer to be like, oh, that's weird. That's not how I would have pronounced that at all. So for those of us that were dumb, it's good to be corrected. But if people are looking for more from you, where can they find you?
Well, I write for thebourbonculture.com. You can look us up on our website or at our Instagram at thebourbonculture. So yeah, give us a follow and see what we have to say.
Beautiful. Well, thank you so much for everyone for joining us tonight. Nick, Will, and Mike, it has been an absolute pleasure. If you're looking for more from John, you can find him at The Bourbon Finder. Both on Instagram or thebourbonfinder.com. He has all sorts of great coverage. He actually just covered Seagrass, which was a super fun barrel release, not to toot their horn too many times one night, but that rye is fucking great. And his review is awesome, so check it out. And if you're looking for more from me, I'm Jay from Whiskey Raiders. You can find me. Yeah, there we go. There's that beautiful green and blue over on my screen. Love the Seagrass. And if you're looking for more from me over at Whiskey Raiders, and I run the Our Bourbon Single Barrel program, so check up. We will have an update on these two barrels coming up soon. And then we'll get some sweet bottles in everyone's hands. But thank you guys for joining us. It's been awesome drinking whiskey with you all. And cheers. And cheers. We'll catch you in the green room. We'll have a couple of drinks off screen.
Sounds great.
Cheers.
Cheers. Thank you.